يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. Indeed, all praise and glory belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him, we seek His aid and His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evils inside of us and from our evil actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can lead astray. And whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can guide. I testify that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is one and He has no partners. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and final messenger to the whole of mankind. My respected brothers and sisters in Islam, we are of course surrounded and live in the dunya and we become preoccupied with the dunya. But we need something that consistently and constantly reminds us that our purpose in life is what? To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that consistent and constant reminder is only as-salah. It is as-salah which is the fundamental and the backbone of our entire lives. When you look at the other pillars in Islam, Ramadan is intense, it's for a month. Hajj is intense, it's for a few people, for a few days. Zakat is intense when we pay it, but the only pillar of Islam that constantly, every day reminds us about our purpose in life is as-salah, and this is what we'll cover in the khutbah today, inshallah. And regarding as-salah, the Prophet ﷺ said, the head of the matter is Islam, its pillar is salah, and jihad is its peak. So the pillar of Islam is what? Is as-salah. When you look at the importance of salah, some things remind us and tell us of the importance of salah. Look and remind yourselves of how salah was revealed. Salah was the only pillar that was revealed in the heavens. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went on perhaps his most important journey, Al-Isra wal-Miraj, he goes from Masjid Al-Aqsa, leads of Anbiya in salah, he goes to the heavens and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala communicates directly with him. And what is the communication about? What is the commandment? As-salah, as-salah. From 50 to 5 as we know, but this shows us the importance of salah. It is a direct command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah in the heavens, it is as-salah. You look at our lives, they all feel like they revolve around the salah. When a baby is born, the first thing that's done, you call in the adhan, you call in the ear of the baby the adhan, which is a part of salah. And when then 60, 70, 80 years later, when that person's janazah is read, the ikama is called. It is as if the life is just from the adhan to the ikama, this short time. And we know this is the short time that we pray two rakat, as if our whole lives start with a symbolism of salah and they end with a symbolism of salah. But often during that meantime, when we are in control, we are in charge, what happens to our salah? When it comes to praying salah, we make excuses. You know, I'm busy, I'm traveling, I'm ill, etc., etc. Look at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If anyone could have been easy with salah, it is upon him. But even when the Muslims were in war, imagine, in a state of jihad, and their enemies are in front of them, the Muslims, they would engage in two halves, and they would pray salah. What excuse do we have that we can't pray salah when the companions of Rasulullah and Rasulullah himself in a state of war, danger, daggers, swords, spears, but salah must be prayed. This is the place, the position, the maqam of salah. If anyone can be easy upon themselves when it comes to salah, it's Rasulullah. Look at this hadith, listen to this hadith where it said, on Saturday or the final days of his life, the Prophet felt that he was well enough to perform the prayer. So he went out leaning on two men in order to perform the noon prayer. Abu Bakr, who was about to lead the prayer, withdrew when he saw him. The Prophet made a gesture to him and said, seat me next to him. They seated him on the left side of Abu Bakr. The Prophet led the salah and Abu Bakr followed him and raised his voice at every Allahu Akbar so the people may hear it clearly. Look, imagine, this is Rasulullah. He's coming out, he's the one, all of his sins are forgiven. But in the end of the life, just to pray in Jamaat, he's coming out and he's being helped by two people. He's praying whilst sitting. His voice is not loud enough that the Jamaat can hear him. if anyone can be easy upon themselves with salah, it is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But no, just to pray in Jama'ah, just to pray in the companions, look at the difficulty he goes through. This is the importance of as-salah. In a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ told us, the first thing that the slave will be held accountable for on Yawmul Qiyamah is his salah. If it is good, then all of his affairs will be good. And if it is ruined, all of his affairs will be ruined. Hadith in Tabarani. Imagine, Yawmul Qiyamah, when you are alone, naked, uncircumcised, but too scared to look at anybody else. When the rivers, they are set ablaze. When the sun, it comes down so close. When the mountains, they crumble. When mother runs from son. When husband runs from wife. On that day, if your salah is in order, you're saved, inshallah. But if your salah is in a state of, you know, disrepair and disrepute, you didn't pray it, everything else after that will be so difficult. Imagine, this is the thing about salah. On that day, you will see the benefits of salah, of it. So the first thing you're going to be asked about is as-salah. Some of us, we want to change the world. Yes, this is important. But the single most important thing you will be asked about when the communication is between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will speak to us without any intermediaries. You and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be asking you about your salah. This is the importance of as-salah. And salah, we move on now, having looked at the importance, we look at the reward of salah. What do I gain from this? Again, look in Quran, Surah 23, verses 9 to 11. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, successful indeed are the believers. Remember this. The believers will be successful. We are successful. Sometimes we look around at dunya and the ummah is in a bad way and we feel down and we feel miserable. Yes, things are difficult, but Allah is promising us in the Quran, successful indeed are the believers. And then a number of characteristics are described. We will look at two of them. So the first, second characteristics, those, they offer their salah with submissive and solemn and like with khushu. They offer their salah with khushu, with humbleness, with humiliating themselves in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they offer their salah with khushu. Then some other characteristics are mentioned, but another one is mentioned again, and those who strictly guard their prayers. This is important. They don't just pray their salah with khushu, but they guard their prayers, they don't skip their prayers, they're vigilant about their salah. Just like you're vigilant about your job, you make sure you're on time, you make sure you do, you're vigilant. You're vigilant about looking after your family, you don't want them to, you're vigilant. In the same way, they are vigilant, they guard their salah. It's something really important. Life is one salah to another salah. So Allah says in Quran, they guard their salah. They are indeed the inheritance. They're going to get something, but inheritance is something that comes a bit later. You don't get your inheritance, it comes later. They are indeed inheritors who shall inherit Jannah, they shall live therein forever. This is the reward. This is the promise for the salah. It's what? When you pray with khushu and you guard your salah, it is al-Jannah. But again, for many of us, the Jannah, it doesn't resonate. It doesn't impact because we're surrounded by dunya. Remember the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. The least person in Jannah will have the whole dunya and 10 times its like. Imagine, the whole dunya. We can't imagine that we will even own 5, 10, 50. We can't imagine any of this. But imagine you will be owned and have more than anything, more than the kings and the palaces that ever had. You will have the whole dunya and 10 times it. And that's the least person in Jannah, the last person in Jannah. You can't imagine what the earlier ones were. And what were their primary characteristics? Offering salah. Moving on, the Prophet ﷺ, and he describes things in a very simple manner, timeless manner. Everyone from child to old person, from back in the time of Rasul to now with modern technology, everyone can understand. This is the wisdom of Islam. This is the wisdom of Islam. He says to his companions, tell me, if there is an overflowing river in front of the house of one of you, in which he bathes 5 times a day, will there remain any dirt on him? You have a bath 5 times, a shower, whatever, 5, will there remain? And they said, no dirt will remain on him. He then said, that is the example of the 5 daily salahs by which Allah erases the sins. Imagine, just how water it cleans it from dirt, and now you know with this virus going around, fundamental is what? Washing regularly. This is one of the best preventative measures that you can do. It's part of our sunnah, part of our Islam. Remember, do wudu, wash, and wash. They show on TV how to wash their hands now. In the same way, washing thoroughly, this is our sunnah of the Prophet. And but he said, just in the same way, this water keeps us clean, the salah, inshallah, it keeps us clean from the minor sins. Because all the time we're doing sins that we shouldn't be doing, salah, inshallah, our sins drop off with every drop of water when we make wudu. This is the benefit of a salah. These are the rewards that we're getting. We commit sins. Inshallah, salah is a forgiving of the sins. We move on and we see that it prevents evil. So we look at the importance of salah. We look at the rewards of salah. And what else does it do? It prevents evil. Allah says in Quran, Surah 29, verse 45. Verily, salah prevents from al-fahsha, meaning great sins of every kind, and al-munkar. Salah, it prevents you from doing evil. Because generally, not exclusively, but generally, if a person does five times salah, he'll be more conscious of Allah. He'll be more avoiding the sins because he knows he wants to commit a sin. He wants to go out with his girlfriend. I've got to pray salah in half an hour's time. He's not going to do it. He wants to go. And remember, he's a person regular on salah. He's out, he's gambling, something haram or nightclub, but he's regular on his salah. When he prays fajr, I feel so bad. All those things, but because he's remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So salah, it prevents the evil. So no matter what you're doing, maybe you're doing this haram and that haram and this haram, this is wrong. You must stop it. But no matter what you're doing, continue praying salah. Because salah one day will help you leave that sin. Never abandon your salah. Never let shaitan whisper to you, you know, you're doing this wrong and you're doing this wrong and you're doing, give up, what good is salah to you? No, this is the whispering of shaitan. One day this salah, it will strengthen your heart. When you abandon your salah because of the so-called sins that you're doing, this sin of abandoning salah will dwarf all those sins. See, all these sins, and you thought, okay, because of them, I can't do that. The minute you stop your salah, they will become tiny. Because leaving your salah is from the most major of the sins. So salah, it prevents evil. Salah, inshallah, it is a forgiveness for us when we do sin. Again, we see a narration where Ibn Mas'ud reports, a man, he kissed a woman. He came to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and informed him about it. Imagine, it's not easy, someone to come to Rasulullah, but it shows us again, you know, the character of Rasulullah, somebody can come and tell him this. You know, but you did it. No. He listens to the person. This is the wisdom, the hikmah, the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He listened to the man. He listened to him. He said, then Allah revealed an ayah of Quran and performed a salah between the two ends of the day and some hours of the night. Verily, the good deeds erase the evil deeds. So do the salah, inshallah, it will forgive you, it'll erase that bad thing. The man asked the Messenger of Allah whether this applies to him only. The Messenger of Allah said, it applies to all of my ummah. All of my, this applies to us. This is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That when we do a sin, when we perform our salah in the morning and the evening, inshallah, it is again a raising of our sins. Next, we look at the consequences of not praying. So, yeah, we don't pray perhaps, we think it's got no consequence. Listen carefully to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ and the ayat in Quran. He said, what lies between a man and kufr is abandoning the salah. This is the only pillar, he said, to the physical pillars. What lies between iman and kufr is abandoning of the salah. Cannot get a more weightier or heavier set. Because all of this Islam, it's about our iman, it's about believing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is it, this is the crux of the matter. But between this, between tawheed, between la ilaha illallah, between Islam and iman, and kufr and shirk and all of this, the criterion is the salah. Is the salah. Sometimes we leave it and we think it's nothing. It's not nothing. It's the single most important mistake, gravest mistake you are making. And if you die in this condition, you have to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to answer to everything He gave you, and in return, what did He ask from you? And the core of this is as-salah. We see a Quran, Mudathir, Surah 74, verse 42 to 48. Informing us, this is about people in hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they will be asked, What caused you to enter hellfire? So imagine, they are burning, they are suffering, they are eating from the tree of Zakum, they are drinking from the worst liquid, all this boiling, in all of this condition, they'll be asked in this pain and suffering and hardship, what made you come here? Well, how could you enter here? What caused you to enter hellfire? They will say what? The first thing they will say, we were not amongst those who prayed. It's their first answer. The first thing, and they will know. See, this is the thing. You sit here and we're not praying Salah. And we get up and we walk away, carry on with our afternoon. No, we just carry on. We think it means nothing. But one day it will mean everything. This is the point. On that day, you will know exactly, exactly why you arrived in this worst of places. They will say, what? We were not those who prayed, nor did we feed the needy. We used to deny the Day of Judgment. The Yom Kiyamah never crossed my mind. Everything else that's important, my job interview, my child's exam, I worry about it. But Yom Kiyamah, we never used to even think about it. We used to deny the Day of Judgment until they came to that which is certain, which is al-maut, and there is no intercession by any intercessors would benefit them. Nobody's going to come on your behalf now. No one's going to step up and say, Fulan, 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 Fulan did this. No, 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 no. It's too late. It's over. Game over. So this is the problem. We hear over and over, pray, brother, pray. Ah, wahi, leave me alone. I'm a good person. Haven't you anything better to do today? This is our attitude. We think it's nothing. We think it's nothing. And we carry on like that. But there'll come a point when death comes. Then it's just too late after that. It's too late. And then the person, he will know, he will regret all of these times. أقول قول هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفر إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم. Continue, my respected brothers and sisters in Islam. So alhamdulillah, inshallah, we're those people that we pray. But then there's something else about the quality of our salah. I'm not talking about making wudu properly, the fake, keeping your robe straight, making sure there's no gap. Alhamdulillah. Just move on from that for a second. I'm talking about your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in salah. This is the khushu. This is understanding what you're saying and feeling what you're saying. And this is so dramatic. This is what elevates the companions to a position where it's authentically narrated. Rasulullah goes out on a battle, on a skirmish, and there are two of the Sahab, they're guarding him. So the companion guarding, right? The enemies come, and they fire their arrows, and they strike one of the companions. And he doesn't scream out. He doesn't call to the people, he doesn't wake them up, he doesn't, until he reaches the end of his salah. He's bleeding, he's suffering, he's in pain. But his level is so, his khushu is so high. His intimacy with his surah, the words of Allah is so high, the pain, it means nothing to him. This is khushu. This is khushu. Whereas with us, where did I leave my keys today? Well, I've got a job, yeah, I've got to finish my report by 3 o'clock. Yeah. All these things, the smallest thing is going through our mind. But some of them, they reach the level where their blood is still pouring from them. But their khushu is so high, it just takes them to a tight, and this is what we're lacking. And many of us still, even up to this point, we still, this applies mainly to non-Arabs, we still don't understand any of the Quran. Even Surah Al-Fatiha, the 7 most important repeated verses in the Quran, we repeat it tens of thousands of times. We reach our old age, our hair becomes white. We said this surah tens of thousands of times, and we don't understand the meaning of even Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in. You ask people, they don't know. They don't know. Yeah, when we were a kid, we learned at madrasa, I don't know anymore. The Prophet said in a hadith, when any of you is engaged in the salah, hadith al-Bukhari, he's holding an intimate conversation with his Lord. Salah is a conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine someone came, they spoke to you in French and you didn't understand it. They spoke next day again. After a week or so, you'd feel bad. You would learn a little bit of French, just so that you can speak politely to that person. You would, this is good akhlaq. Every time he's speaking to me, I'm going to learn his language just so that I understand the basics. We communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thousands of times. These verses are repeated tens of thousands of times, and we don't take a few hours of our life to learn the meaning. To learn the meaning. What real touching is in our hearts? Where's the khushu gone? The Prophet said, the worst type of thief is the one who steals from his salah. He said, O Messenger of Allah, how can a person steal from his salah? He said, by not doing ruku and sujood properly. You know, again, really like a bird pecking, and like another narration, like a sparrow just gets its seed and lifts its head up again. This is how many of us we pray our salah. Rather, sujood is a time for dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a time of reflection, pondering, thinking. We move on and we close the khutbah, my respected brothers in Islam and sisters, by talking about Al-Jumma. Al-Jumma, perhaps the most important salah, congregational salah, let's remind ourselves. So again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds in the Quran, there's a whole surah called Surah Al-Jumma. And we get a look at this and we see a couple of verses. Allah says, O you who believe, when the call is proclaimed for salah on Jumma, come to the remembrance of Allah and salah and leave off business. This is very important. That is better for you if you did know. We're told as soon as we know the salah time is about, we don't have timetables today, leave your business, leave your work and come to, this is better for you if you know. Again, even now, how many people do we know are lax? Even in Jummah, we don't bother praying. I've worked in places, but alhamdulillah, we have a prayer room. And the people, they establish Jummah in there, and they're Muslims in the same building. Can't walk down and pray Jummah. It's wrong. Major sin, major. Allah's commanding you in Quran, when you know the call of prayer and Jummah is made, leave your business. That'll be the most successful for you. Indeed, if you knew, that is better for you. We think it's better for us if I sell those extra things, if I do two more jobs on my taxi, if I finish this on my tax return. We think all these things are better. That's shaitan in your mind. Allah's telling us in Quran, it's better if you left it and you came. And then we're told that when salah has ended, disperse through the land and seek the bounties of Allah and remember Allah much that you may be successful. This is the wisdom of Islam. Doesn't mean you stay in the masjid all day long. After salah has finished, you pray your sunnah, off you go. Go earn your money. This is the sunnah as well. This is the beauty of Islam. It tells us about ibadah, what you're doing, and then go on, earn your dunya, earn your living, look after your family. But again, remember Allah. This is how you'll be successful. This is the wisdom and the beauty of Islam. It's not extreme in any way. We continue focusing on Salatul Jummah. The hadith in Bukhari, the Prophet has told us, whoever does ghusl from Janabah on Jummah, then leaves for the masjid as if he has sacrificed a camel. Whoever comes in the second hour, it's as if he sacrificed a cow. Whoever comes at the third hour, it's as if he sacrificed a horned ram. Whoever comes at the fourth hour, it's as if he sacrificed a chicken. Whoever comes out in the fifth hour, it's as if he sacrificed an egg. Then when the imam comes out, the angels come in to listen to the reminder. So there is benefit and there is barakah for coming early. Look at the difference between a camel, big, expensive, huge animal, and an egg. This is the wisdom. Anybody can understand this. The time of Rasulullah, or even the kids in the internet age, you get it. Camel and the egg is obvious. This is the difference. And our Rasul describes the different levels of how enthusiastic people are. Of course, sometimes people are working, Islam is with your wisdom, you come when you can, alhamdulillah. But particularly when you're on holiday or you're not working, the earlier you can come and particularly pray in the front row, you'll get the great ajr, inshallah. Hadith in Bukhari. If the salah has started, do not approach it running, but approach it walking, with calmness. Whatever what you catch with salah, pray it, and what you miss, complete it. Again, when you come to the masjid, come with a degree of calmness. Okay, you think you're going to be late, walk a bit faster, but you should not be charging around, pushing people out of the way. This is not the way. And again, most of us, we come in our cars. And again and again and again and again, I must make it for salah, and we park our cars anyway. We disturb our neighbours, they come back to us. This is wrong. You know, for many of our neighbours, the only interaction they have with us is our cars outside. And so many times, the people in our own experience in this masjid are complaining, and councils are coming back to us. And you can just imagine them, another masjid, these Muslims again, parking. They know it. Then if you work in planning services, they know it. this is embarrassing for us. And they're all dreading, Ramadan is coming, we know exactly what's going to happen again. This is wrong. What is the sunnah? When it comes to salah, whatever you catch it, pray it. Whatever you miss it, make up for it. It's wisdom, it's sunnah. Rather than you're parking, you're crashing, you're blocking people. I've seen cars literally across pavements. You know, blind person has to go, a wheelchair has to go along. And you literally parked your car, it's wrong, it's wrong. The sunnah, what is the sunnah? Just again, wisdom. So again, not rushing, generally when it comes to salah. Trying to pray again in the front row, we mentioned this. And then finally we conclude by not pushing between the people. The Prophet says, when you enter into a gathering, do not sit between two persons, rather sit on their left or right side. Rasulullah said, no one is to sit between two people without their permission. How many times have we experienced that? We're trying to pray, there's a tiny, like 5 centimeter gap between us, and somebody's nudging in and pushing us to our outside. Actually, this is very annoying, particularly for old people as well. They've come early, they've got their space, and everybody's crowding in and pushing everybody. But this is wrong. That's why it's a sunnah. Don't sit between two people without their permission. Brother, may I? Then please, may I? Come on, you know, may I? Sunnah, may I? If you like, alhamdulillah. If not, I'll go to the side, no problem. If not, I'll pray outside in the extension, no problem. You'll get more reward because you didn't disturb these brothers. They arrived on time, you came late. This is sunnah, wisdom. Don't push between people. Be their good manners, be a good way. Listening to the khutbah. Again, from my vantage point, I get to see people often. So many times you see people at the start playing with their mobile phones. Even if the khutbah is boring, it's not a question that's boring, still, you don't have the right to put your phone out. The Prophet said, and then we start talking to each other. We start, if you say to your companion when the Imam is preaching on Jummah, be quiet and listen, you have engaged in idle talk. Even this is wrong. You think it's good, brother, please be quiet. No, even that, you can't say it. In another narration, he told us, don't play with stones. You know, at that time in the desert, and you'd have stones, people start playing, flicking stones around. No, this is wrong, this is sinful behavior. And today, we're doing anything but that. I've seen many times, you come, people sitting, playing with phones, and catching other things. This is wrong. You know, everything has a theme, and etiquette, and mannerisms, and Jummah is no different. So again, we conclude the khutbah, my respected brothers and sisters in Islam. Salah was that thing. Was revealed in the heavens. You will be judged about it on Yawm al-Qiyamah again, away from this earth. Yes, on this earth you do, and this is not a religion of compulsion. You have a choice, but don't forget, what was revealed in the heavens will be judged for you on that time as well. It is the way to have a peaceful and successful life. You know, who of us can't spare half an hour today to pray Salah? We've got half an hour for shopping, half an hour for weights, half an hour for media, half an hour for anything else. But if you don't have half an hour for salah, from the one who created you and gave you everything that you have. Allahumma ighfirlana dhunubana wa kaffirna sayyi'atina. Allahumma qina adhab al-dunya wa adhab al-akhirah. Allahumma aghfir lil-mu'min mu'minat wal-muslim muslimat. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab al-nar wa aqim as-salah.